One of my favorite astrophotographers, Bray Falls, published his initial 2024 eclipse image. His work inspired me to write this essay. I wish to talk about how the sun is connected to the planets. I'm particularly struck by the filaments reaching out from the sun. Each planet is connected to the sun through these filaments. Matter, energy, and information are transferred out and back through these filaments, and much else, which we will learn about in the future. We have known about these coronal filaments for decades, but only recently learned that they stretch out through the solar system. What is the body of the sun? It is much larger than that bright disk in the sky. If we were to travel to that bright orb, we would be traveling to the heart of the sun's body, or the brain, or the nucleus of the sun. The actual sun is something of almost incomprehensible grandeur. The entire known solar system is part of the body of the sun. Here are two more eclipse photos from Bray Falls. The one on the left shows that there are two distinct structures, the polar lines, which reach out of the north and south poles of the sun, and perpendicular to this, a more complex skirt of lines in which the planets live. Look at the 2017 picture. I've highlighted the polar lines in yellow. The polar lines extend out and around, forming a torus, whose size is not yet known, but the orbits of the planets are certainly very small in comparison. From this point of view, the body of the sun is an enormous torus. This torus shape appears as the basic plan for the electromagnetic body of people, planets, stars, and galaxies. That is worth pondering. I do not know of many other structures like this torus that appear in organisms over such a range of sizes. This polar structure is the overall structure of the body of the sun. What about the other class of filaments, the ones that stretch out into the plane of the solar system where all the planets live? Plasma often forms tubes. We've all seen plasma balls. In a cosmic setting, just like in your body, these tubes in the solar system transfer matter, energy, and information. Everything we know about biological transport tubes also applies to the cosmic realm. This second class of filaments are a transport system between the sun and the planets, exactly like your arteries and veins. All living systems need to have some kind of a tubing for a transport system, and plasma naturally forms tubes. The filaments maintain their separateness all the way out to each planet. The figure below is a cartoon of these solar filaments as presented in a study by Barofsky in 2008. The left panel shows that the tubes extend for great distances yet remain separate. The right panel shows what they look like in cross-section. And there's very good evidence that the filaments originate from the granules on the photosphere. This gives a very lively and a very structured picture of interplanetary space. Most people watching this channel are already realizing that these flux tubes are a form of Birkeland currents. Mainstream astrophysics is catching up, and no, none of us in the EU community will be given any recognition. In an otherwise wonderful paper by Russell et al. In 2020, in their figure 2, we see a diagram of the flux tube, which is, of course, the same as that proposed by Don Scott, based upon initial work by Lundquist, neither of which are referenced. The blue line is the direction of the magnetic field, which in the very center is along the axis. And then as you move outward, the magnetic field spirals and eventually circles around the flux rope. Most EU nerds know that if you continue to increase the amount of current flowing, then the magnetic field and electric current will reverse spiral and eventually head back in a return current. This flux tube structure was verified against the one-dimensional data from the MMS satellites that passed through such tubes. I had expected the solar tubes to connect directly to the north and south poles of the Earth, but not so. The solar ropes connect at the Earth's equator, and the input energy then heads to the poles where it enters the body of the Earth. In their figure 3, panel A, we are looking down on the north pole of the Earth and the Sun is to the left. The flux tube connection events are the crosses and triangles. You can see that they connect just about everywhere facing the Sun. In panel C, we are looking at the Earth from the Sun direction. And this shows that all the flux tube connections happened along the equator of the Earth. I do not know the meaning of the sinusoidal hump in the middle. In addition, Russell et al. Found that half the flux tubes are filled with electrons and ions, and half are mostly just ions with very few electrons. We natural philosophers enjoy theories that have predictive power. Could anyone have predicted all this recent data about solar flux tubes? Consider two astronomers, Alice and Bob. Alice is a materialist. She believes the universe is random, except for the laws of physics, which she believes have no purpose. She is convinced that if she has not seen something, then it cannot be true. Alice is surprised that flux tubes even exist. Isn't there just random gas between us and the Sun? And why should there be two types of tubes? In our little drama, Alice speaks for such scientists as David Seibeck of the Goddard Space Flight Center, who said about Russell's results, 10 years ago, I was pretty sure they didn't exist, but now the evidence is incontrovertible. And elsewhere he said, we used to think the connection was permanent and that the solar wind would trickle into the near-Earth environment anytime the wind was active. We were wrong. The connections are not steady at all. They are often brief, bursty, and very dynamic. About the two types of flux tubes, presciently named active and passive flux tube events, Seibeck further said, passive flux tube events may not be very important, but until we know more about it, we can't be sure. In all this, we see the hubris of the materialist mind, which states that something is false until it is either seen with our own watery orbs or seen by something made of glass and metal. Going over to Bob, Bob knows, feels, and senses that he lives in a living universe. There must be some sort of nourishment coming from the Sun to the planets. He knows that all life on Earth is fed by the Sun. Perhaps all life on Earth comes from the Sun. Further, Bob has seen that living systems require membranes and transport systems. In his own body, each organ is surrounded by a unique type of membrane which separates that organ from the rest of the body. And there are tubes which transport materials and information into and out of that organ. The same blueprint also applies to each living cell on Earth. Hence, Bob might actually predict that between the Sun and the Earth, there would be tubes made of plasma, which carry material, energy, and information, and connect to the magnetic membrane of the Earth. He might organically jump to the idea that there must be at least two types of connection, because there must be an in and an out, a systole and a diastole, or an active and a passive interplay. The observed pulse rate for tubes connecting to the magnetosphere is about once every 8 minutes, which I admit is quicker than I expected. There must be some form of impedance or voltage matching between the tube and the magnetosphere, so the 100,000 volts found across a flux tube is not a surprise, since that is the energy scale of the magnetosphere electrons. All these facts are not a surprise. Further, Bob knows that matter, energy, and information must also travel from Earth back to the Sun, which is not yet mentioned in any paper I can find, so it is only a matter of time before that is discovered. Jumping up a level, Look at this picture of the galaxy NGC 5775. The optical image is from Hubble, and it's combined with radio data from VLA. The wispy blue lines are the magnetic fields of the galaxy. Do not take the lines too literally, as the magnetic field is difficult to map exactly, but it sure gives the right idea. What is the body of the galaxy? In closing, I'd like to say that with the now famous Mother's Day 2024 solar flares behind us, the question is again in the air about the sun causing a catastrophe for humanity. I realize that some of my views on this topic have been misunderstood or misrepresented. I have said in several settings that the Earth has nothing to fear from such flares. This statement has been turned into me saying that humanity will be fine, no matter what the sun does. Not so. A solar micronova of the type Ben Davidson has been so expertly educating us on would end humanity's electrical grid, and then just watch us tear each other to shreds. Heck, humans have torn each other apart for much less than this. All I've ever said on this topic is that the Earth will be fine. The visible sun stands to the planets as our heart or brain does to our organs. Your heart is not going to kill your liver. I mean, unless the whole system is so messed up that everything is going haywire, or unless the system is undergoing a metamorphosis at the level of caterpillar becoming butterfly, like a supernova, then yes, everything old must go away. A solar flare is not going to decimate Earth or Jupiter, because our solar system is a living organism. As for humanity, well, I guess the last 4 years have taught some of us lessons on what to do when humanity goes haywire. Thank you.